5, 4, 3, 2, 1. 21 days of prayer, everybody. Come on, who's excited? Who's awake? Who's ready to worship the Lord? I'm so excited that you're here. So glad that you've made it this morning. I have been up since, what, 3-something. I just couldn't wait to come and see you. And you have just encouraged my heart today to be here and to be ready to worship the Lord and to pray. And maybe some of you had a little bit of opposition. How many of you had a little bit of a struggle getting here this morning? Anybody? No? Okay, a few of you. I would expect that because we're coming to seek the Lord. And one of our worship leaders locked the keys in his house at 4 a.m., couldn't make it. And I just went, well, that's just par for the course. That's not locking your keys. That's the enemy trying to keep you from being here. But come on, stand to your feet. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice. Come on, put your hands together. I will rejoice and be glad into it. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, into his courts with praise. We will know that he is the Lord and that he is here. We're going to sing praises to his name. Come on, let's worship the Lord.
Every chain will break, his broken heart's declaring his praise.
Come on, worship the Lord this morning. Come on. Come on, let's give him a great hand of praise today. We love you, Lord. Oh, it's so good to praise you, Lord. We love you, Lord, with all of our hearts. Amen. Come on, you can be seated. So glad that you're here this morning. Come on, put your hands together for all those who are joining us online and cars and in kitchens, living rooms, getting your kids ready. I'm so glad you're here with us today. I love the 21 days of prayer, and I love you. I love it that you are here to pray and to seek God. You know, this is the work of the church. I don't know if you know that. It's not that we're going to do anything in our own power to change. I know that every Sunday. I know that there's no way that singing a few songs and a few words from my mouth is going to change anybody's life. But we have a team of intercessors that pray through every service that we have, because prayer changes things, everybody. And that's why I'm so excited about 21 days of prayer, where the whole church comes together and prays, because I know that God is going to do something to change your life. And we're going to focus on the Holy Spirit for the next 21 days, having a real personal encounter with Him. And I know that God is going to do something wonderful for all of you and unite us. One of the signs of this Holy Spirit is a church in one accord, right? A church united. And when you see that we're in trouble like we are in a nation and everybody's so divided and polarized, let me show you something. Here's that verse again. Whenever people were in trouble and they turned to the Lord and they sought Him, guess what? They found Him, because He was right there all along. And I'm so excited you've shown up today, just even physically, just by logging in. You're telling God, I want to find you. I want to seek you. And God is going to hear your prayer. He's going to hear from heaven, and He's going to turn. He's going to heal some things, and He's going to heal our land through us. So real quick, before we jump in, some of you, this is your very first 21 days of prayer, and I'm just so glad that you're here and you're a part of this. I want to orient you, take a couple minutes just to remind you of what we do. So the format of the 21 days of prayer service is that we do what the Bible says. We always start with a song of praise. We enter into His gates with thanksgiving, enter into His courts with praise. And so we just take a minute to acknowledge our God, and we worship Him. And then we always take a short time in God's Word, because faith is what makes prayer work, right? But faith comes from hearing of the Word of God. So we're going to have a few moments, just a short time in God's Word every day, and then I'm going to turn you loose to pray for the next 25 minutes or so, where on your own, you just pray. And during that time of prayer, I just encourage you to do a couple things, just to be active. Don't just fall back to sleep or just sit. Yeah, some of you might need to stand up, and some of you can walk around. Some of you might want to kneel, but whatever you do, do something active to focus your body, especially if you're at home and maybe you're just kind of laying in bed with your phone right now. I encourage you just to get up and to walk around and don't fall back to sleep. Or maybe just stand and pray. Find a posture that'll help focus you to pray. One of the things I like to do is I like to walk. So you'll see me just walking around. And it just keeps me moving because I want to focus our prayer. And then you'll hear worship music that's being played. And for some of you, it might seem a little too loud. But the reason why we do that on purpose is so that I want to encourage you to say your prayers. When I say that faith comes from hearing of the Word of God, I'm encouraging you to pray out loud in a way that you can hear your own voice. I'm not asking you to pray loud to draw attention to yourself or to distract anybody else from what they're praying, but just loud enough so that you can hear. And one of the ways that I want to encourage you to pray is that some of us never learned how to pray. We would just run out of words in 30 seconds. So we have made for you this little prayer guide called Prayer First, and it is filled with scriptural prayers. It's got patterns of prayer, like the Lord's Prayer. There's a pattern of prayer modeled on the tabernacle. There's a pattern of prayer that is just praying scriptural prayers, all kinds of pages on scriptural prayers, other prayers, spiritual warfare kind of prayers, prayers for healing. And it gives scripture, and I just encourage you, the best kind of prayer to pray is to just pray the Word of God. And this is the Word of God turned into prayers, and you know, you're basically praying to God His Word. And that means that you're praying according to the will of God, right? And so God is going to answer those prayers. There's prayers for how to pray for people who are far from God. And you'll notice these little white post-it notes all around the room, the names of people who are in great need. They need a miracle from God. And so there are scriptural prayers in here that'll help you pray for people. So I encourage you, say those prayers out loud. And that's why the music is there, to give everyone some privacy so that they can pray out loud. It'll help you focus. One other resource that we have is, since we're focusing on the Holy Spirit, we have a little booklet called Encounter, 21 Days to a Fresh Encounter with the Holy Spirit. This was written by one of our regional presidents in Converge, Gary Rohrmeier. He's the man who actually called me to come to Indianapolis, and he's written several books on prayer, and this is one of his best ones. So we've made that available. We've purchased those so that you can just pick one up and read. I also want to welcome our national president of Converge. His name is President Scott Rideout. He's here with us today. Would you give him a great hand? I just want to honor him, and so glad you've come here for the first day, and honored that you're joining us. Let me just jump into a quick little bit of God's word, and then we'll cut you loose to prayer. I really want to help you understand the person of the Holy Spirit. So for the first 9 days of the 21 days, I'm going to talk to you, our leaders are going to talk to you about the person and the power of the Holy Spirit, how he works in our lives. And then the last 9 days, we're going to focus each day on one of the ways that the Holy Spirit produces something in us. We're going to learn about walking with the Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit. And there's 9 fruits of the Spirit. So that's 18 days plus Sundays is 21 days. Now today, the person of the Holy Spirit, who is he? Well, I want to remind you, he's a person. He's not an it. It's not some impersonal force. The Holy Spirit is a person. And one of the things that makes you a person, different from anything else, is that you have a mind, and you have emotions, and you have a will. So the Holy Spirit has a mind, and he has emotions, and he has a will. So Romans 8:27 says, he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit has a mind. Ephesians 4:30 shows us the Holy Spirit has emotions, where it says, don't grieve the Holy Spirit of God. Don't you know that the Holy Spirit can actually be sad about things that he sees, and what he sees in our own lives and the pain that we suffer? So don't grieve the Holy Spirit of God, whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. And then talking about the will, like you have the ability to choose things. That's what the will is. Well, the Holy Spirit has that ability to choose. 1 Corinthians 12:11 talks about his will. But the one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as he wills. So the Holy Spirit is a person, which means that you can get to know him. If you never realize that he's a person, you won't relate to him personally. And so he's a person to get to know. And the more you get to know him, you're going to be changed. And this is so important because, again, God's not distant. He's not from a distance watching us. He's not God in heaven. He is in heaven, and Jesus is in heaven. But the Holy Spirit is God in the now that wants to walk with you and fill you and empower you and help you and strengthen and counsel and comfort and everything that you need. And I said it yesterday that most people, they don't know anything about the Holy Spirit. When the Apostle Paul said, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? It's a haunting question. It's a disturbing question on purpose to say, God, do I have all of you that I'm supposed to have? And so we're going to spend this 21 days getting close and preparing ourselves for the work of the Holy Spirit to come and to fill us. Because the real gospel is, it's not just that Jesus died for our sins, everybody, which is great. I'm glad he did, so I could come close to God. But he said, the same Spirit that came upon me in my baptism is now available to you. How many of you are glad for that? That the Spirit of God wants to come and fill you personally. It is not just a God that's far away. He's actively reaching out to you. And so the one thing I would just share, I could talk an hour about the Holy Spirit, but I just want to get out of your way. Let me just share the one thing that happens when we encounter the Holy Spirit. And that is, every time we come into contact with the Holy Spirit, we are changed. Changed. Just like Moses in the Old Testament, when he went up on the mountain, you know, it says that they saw that he was changed. Why? Because his face was glowing. They were like, I don't know what happened, but he's been in the presence of God. His face, his countenance, it was radiating because he'd been in the presence of God. He was changed. And so watch this. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, it says, whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now that veil was referring to that curtain that hung in the temple where people couldn't go and access the presence of God. And when Jesus died on the cross, that curtain was split in two. And it showed that everyone now has access to the holy presence of God. So when anyone turns to the Lord, because of what Jesus did on the cross, we can come boldly into God's presence. But now, okay, the Spirit, the Lord is a spirit. He's the breath of God. And whenever the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom. We're not bound to just try to come up with the effort to and the willpower to follow laws on stone. There's now a Spirit on the inside of us that moves us to want to, that gives us the power and the ability to want to follow God. There's freedom there. And so now we who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory are being changed. That's the goal. That's the goal of the 21 days, that God would change us. So how does he do it? Well, there's preparation that has to happen. For the Holy Spirit to come fill something, we have to empty ourselves of some things. There's a work of preparation. And I found this in just going through the one-year Bible a couple days ago, the story of King Hezekiah and how he was 25 years old when he became king. 2 Chronicles chapter 29 talks about how he was so sad because they had not been in the temple for hundreds of years now. People had abandoned the Lord. They'd gone away. The temple was actually boarded up. In fact, you can read his story. He says he called the people together on the first day of being king, and he said, hey, in 21 days from now, it's Passover, and we have not even celebrated the Passover in hundreds of years as a nation. And his heart was broken about that. So he called them to prepare for this special Passover. It's interesting. It was about 21 days in the future if you do the math. So watch this. He said to them, our ancestors were unfaithful. They did evil in the sight of the Lord. They abandoned the Lord and his dwelling place. So they abandoned gathering for church. Sound familiar? They turned their backs on him. Watch this. They shut the doors to the temple's entry room. So that means they stopped worshiping, because you enter into his gates with thanksgiving, into his courts with praise. So that's a symbol of they quit worshiping the Lord. And then it says they snuffed out the lamps. And the lamp is the symbol of the presence of God, the presence of the Holy Spirit. So that was all gone. So he said, listen to me, you Israelites, purify yourselves and purify the temple of the Lord, the God of your ancestors, and remove all the defiled things from the sanctuary. Previous kings had actually set up idols all over and filled the temple with debris. It had become a storage place. And so it was just desecrated. It was filled with other things. Now that's important, because this isn't just about the Old Testament, right? Everybody understand that the Bible says this, that you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Does that connect? And so what happened is we've allowed things in our own lives. We've got idols. We've got things that are desecrating us, things that are dark, things that are defiling us, things that are deceitful. It's just a part of being human. It's just a part of living in this world today, that some of that stuff from the world gets on the inside of us. And so he called those people back then. He says, purify yourself. Instead of being desecrated, let's consecrate the temple. And so they began the work. Watch this, in verse 17, they began the work of consecration, and it took them 8 days just to get to the entry room of the Lord's temple. I mean, that's how bad it was. It took them 8 days. And then they purified the temple of the Lord, which took another 8 days. So the entire task was completed in 16 days. They had room to spare. I think that's so important, because I think that as you get before the Lord over these 21 days, I don't know what day it'll be for you. For those guys, it took about 16 days to purify and to consecrate themselves. And that's the same thing that's going to happen to you. Is, you know, don't expect that the first day you start praying, Lord, fill me with the Holy Spirit. He may. But for some of you, it might take a few days just to let the Lord work on you and to clean some stuff out. You pray that prayer, Holy Spirit, show me. Holy Spirit, show me to me, like what needs to be cleared out of the way and purify my heart. Create in me a clean heart, oh God. I don't know what day it'll be for you, but there'll be some day before the 21 days is over that your heart and your life is going to be so prepared to receive the Holy Spirit. What did he ask those people to do? He said, purify yourself. So that means start praying, like, Lord, create in me a clean heart. And then the second thing he told them, remove the defiled things. And I always like the 21 days of prayer to be a time of focus where I turn off the world. I shut down some of the media. I stop watching things that, you know, they're not necessarily evil, but they're right in the middle. You know what I'm talking about? And I'm just saying we ought to get out of the middle for 21 days and get as close to the Lord as we can. Prepare ourselves to receive a fresh infilling of the Holy Spirit. And watch this. And in those 16 days, the temple of the Lord was restored to service. Hezekiah and all the people rejoiced because of what God had done for the people. In fact, looking back, it was just a few days. God had done it so quickly. And I love how that whole story ends in the next chapter, at the very end of chapter 30, where it said the people rejoiced because Jerusalem was changed. It wasn't just the temple that got changed, but because of what they did in the temple, the whole city was changed, and they all rejoiced. And the last verse of chapter 30 says, and God heard their prayer from heaven. Isn't that exciting? God's going to hear your prayers from heaven today. So will you all stand to your feet? Come on, let's just begin to pray. Let's just get ready to receive. Lord, I pray over these next few minutes that you would move our heart together, that you would unite us, Lord. I pray that you would fill us with the sense of wonder and of awe. And Lord, before we even pray, we just worship you again. We lift up our hands. We praise you. We thank you, Jesus, for who you are, for what you've done. And we say, Lord, show us now some things about ourselves. Reveal yourself to us. Lord, begin to change us, Lord. We ask you to fill us afresh. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Come on, let's worship the Lord.
Available at the front. There are post-it notes on the back table so that you can post your prayer requests. And we'll meet back here at 6:45 for corporate prayer.
Just one word. You calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word. The darkness has to retreat. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that a God can do. There's not a mountain that he can move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's not And I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. So let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe, come on, for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe, come on, for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like His power. There's nothing that a God can do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way.
I've come to worship.
Come on, let's just turn the glory to Him. Let's just lift it up to Him. We love you, Lord. We praise your name, Lord. We give you the glory. We honor you, Lord. Well, let's just reach up to heaven. We're going to pray together now. The book of Acts says that they prayed together in one accord, and they prayed out loud together, and God shook that place. So I encourage you to pray. If you want to come closer, you can. You don't have to do that, but let's just pray together. Father, we love you. We love you. We adore you. We worship your name today. Lord, we just worship the name of Jesus. Oh, we magnify the name of Jesus. Come magnify the name of Jesus. Let us exalt his name together. Let's just take a few seconds and just praise him and lift up and magnify the name of Jesus, the name above every name. God, we thank you that your name is our righteousness, Lord. I thank you that you're making us clean. You're making us holy. You've made us right before you. Thank you that your name is our sanctifier. I thank you that you've set us apart, that you have called us to be your sons and your daughters. Lord, you've called us to serve you, and you've called us to be in your family. And we're so grateful that you've just set us apart for an assignment that you have for each one of us. You have a purpose for our lives, and we praise you for that. I thank you that you are our shepherd. Holy Spirit, you are the shepherd of our souls, and we have everything that we need today. Lord, you're leading us beside still waters, and you're restoring our soul today. I thank you for how you're changing us. I thank you for how you guide us. I thank you for how you speak to us and how we can hear your voice. I thank you that you care. I thank you that your rod and your staff, they comfort us and they guide us, and you lead us. So we praise you for that today. God, we thank you that we can hear your voice. And so according to John 10, we turn away our ear from the voice of the stranger, and we turn our ear to you, Lord. We recognize your voice, and we want to come close to you, and we want to direct our attention to you today, Spirit of God. Lord, we want to be led by your Spirit. Thank you that your name is our banner of victory over the enemy. Come on, let's just thank him for that. Thank you, Lord, that you've already fought our battles. You've already fought every situation that we're going to face, and you're the victor. We've won the fight in Jesus' name. And even though we walk through valleys of shadows of death, Lord, we will fear no evil, for you are with us. Thank you that your presence is here right now. Thank you that we can even sense your presence, Lord. We know that you are here and you're driving out fear in our lives. You've not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And so we claim that today, that we will not be afraid, will not be full of fear or anxiety. We're going to sit at your table in your presence. Lord, you said we could even be in the presence of our enemies and you'd still give us the peace of your presence. You'd give us that strength today. God, I recognize that we are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus who loved us, and greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. So we're not going to fear today. God, I thank you that you are our healer. Praise him for being your healer today. We love you, Lord. Thank you for healing our souls. You are the restorer of our souls, of our minds, and of our bodies. Thank you that you heal. You not only forgive sins, but you heal all our diseases. So anywhere where we're at dis-ease today, Lord, we just come to you and we ask you to restore us and heal us, Lord. Thank you that you're hearing healing every place in our bodies. Lord, I pray for our church. I pray for people right now, Lord, that they just got a diagnosis of cancer. God, you know the fear that that word strikes in their heart. But God, you are the healer, and you're the one that can mastermind all of their care. And so we say cancer has to go in Jesus' name. We say COVID has to go in Jesus' name. We say diabetes has to go in Jesus' name. Depression has to go in Jesus' name. You are the healer of our bodies and our souls. Thank you that you're removing anxiety from us, every place where we're insecure or we have fear. Lord, so many people just asking, Lord, for calmness of their soul. And God, you are the restorer and the healers of our souls. So we fix our attention on you today, and we remember your word that says, you will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are fixed upon you. So we fix our hearts and our minds on you today. Lord, we will not lack anything. You give us every good thing. You said that if a father knows how to give good gifts to their kids, Lord, how much more will you grant the Holy Spirit to those who ask? So, Lord, we ask you to come and fill us and do a deep work on the inside of us. Lord, we pray that you will change us. Come on, ask him to change you today. Lord, begin to do that deep work on the inside of us. I thank you, Holy Spirit, that you have come, Lord, to be the God in the now. Thank you, Lord, that you are the light on our path. You're the one who guides. You're the hand on our shoulder. You reassure. God, you are the voice in our ear. You tell us which is the right way to go. God, we have you right here. And together, we just pray, Lord, will you change us to be more like your son, Jesus? Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Lord, we don't want to be away from your presence. We want you not to take any part of your Holy Spirit from us, but restore unto us today the joy of our salvation as you fill us again. God, fill us to overflowing. This day, we need more of your love. We need more of your joy. We need more of your peace. We need more of your patience. Come on, thank him for that. God, we need more patience today. We need more of your goodness, more of your faithfulness, more of your gentleness, more of your kindness, more of your self-control. Oh God, we can't do these things without you, but you can come and change us from the inside out. So God, I thank you, Lord, you're gonna minister to us. And as we are changed, Lord, change everyone that we talk to today. Everyone, you said you had like put the shoes of peace on us, that everywhere we go, we're just bringing the peace of God that passes all understanding. Lord, let the change in our life affect others today. Lord, you told us to forgive as we have been forgiven. So Father, I want to thank you for forgiving our trespasses today. Come on, let's just ask him to do a little work in us. God, put a finger on the areas that we don't even know about. God, show us through your Holy Spirit what needs to change. Point out anything that offends you. Search me, O God. Know my heart. Test my anxious thoughts. See if there be anything offensive to you. And lead us in the way of everlasting life. Lord, we admit we've abandoned you. We admit, we confess that we've turned our backs on you, Lord. We confess our lack of worship to you, Lord. We confess that we're the ones who have let idols come into the holy place. And Lord, we ask you to remove anything that defiles, anything that is dark, anything deceptive, anything that's causing us to be polluted, or this temple that you've given us to be defiled in any way. Lord, consecrate us again. Create in us this clean heart, this space where you can come and you can fill. Right now, Lord, we repent of any pride. We repent of any arrogance. We get rid of anger that's in our heart. Come on, just let that go today. God, you said that you would want your people to come together and lift up holy hands and worship to you without anger, without controversy. And God, in this day, it's so easy to be pulled by other allegiances. But we just declare today, you are the Lord. You're the one we follow. You're the one we listen to. We're going to listen to your voice. We're going to be your children. God, you said we're actually aliens in this world. We belong to you. We're citizens of heaven. And God, give us right thinking in our mind today. Lord, change the way that we think. Transform us by the renewing of our minds, Lord, and make us like you. Let any thought that is not of you, Lord, let us take that captive and let us become, let us think thoughts that are pure and lovely and right and good and excellent. Anything that's worthy of praise, we fix our mind on you today. Now, Lord, we forgive others. Let's do that work. We let go of every offense, anything that's we're holding on to, we let it go today because you've forgiven us so much. We don't want to give a foothold to the enemy. No way for him to access our lives today. We reject any lie that says bitterness is better for us. We don't listen to that today. We will not be bitter. We're not going to be filled with outrage about anything because, Lord, we're going to trust you. You're the judge. You're the one who'll settle the score, and we release it to you today. Come on, do that today. Come on, commit to him. You're going to be slow to speak, slow to get angry, quick to listen to his voice. And now, Lord, we go into this day now. We're ready. We've put on the helmet of salvation. We are yours. We're your sons and daughters. We take up a breastplate of righteousness. We put it on. We're going to walk in right things today. Nothing evil in our lives. Lord, truth and integrity around our waist. And we're going to have the shoes of peace that we walk in, Lord. We're going to defeat the plans of the enemy to lead us in any other path. We take up the shield of our faith. And we have the sword of the Spirit, the word of God in our mouths that defeats the lies of the enemy. And we're going to walk in victory today. Come on, we are armed, we're protected. We have nothing to fear. We are strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. We put on the full armor of God. We thank you, Lord. Thank you for what you're going to do in us today. You've given us security. We thank you for peace. We thank you for authority. We thank you for all that you've given us today. We are changed. Come on, declare it. We are changed in Jesus' name. And we give you all the praise, all the glory, all the honor in Jesus' name. Amen and amen and amen. Amen. See, we're always going to get you out on time at 6:55. That's what we're going to do together. We're going to worship the Lord, have a little bit of God's word every day. We're going to turn you loose to pray, and we're going to come back together and pray corporately as one. God's going to unite our hearts together, and then we're going to get you out before 7 o'clock so you can get to work, get to school. Strict 1 hour. So I hope you won't fall off, all right? Make the decision today. Make the decision at home. You're going to be a part of this every day. Do the work. Get in front of God. Let him clean out some things. Let him purify the temple. And watch if just a few days from now, you have a powerful, life-changing encounter with the Holy Spirit. Are you guys excited about that? Go have the best Monday of your lives. I'll see you back tomorrow morning at 6 a.m. God bless you. As the eyes begin to open, and the blindness meets the light.